the different reasons.
I started recording, so if everyone's ready, I'm gonna introduce our speaker today, Lizzie Hanks. Yay! I'm so happy you're here. Welcome everyone. The title of her presentation is Lancaster, Northern Arizona, Corpus of American Spoken English, Lana Case. And I'm gonna hand it over to Lizzie. Welcome.
Thanks, Ellie, and thanks everyone for being here. I am so honored and so excited to talk about this corpus and this project and how it can be utilized in the future for teaching. So let's make sure. Great. So we'll start out with a brief overview of corpus linguistics. I'm sure many of you are here because you're already very familiar with corpus linguistics. So we'll keep that brief and then talk more about the corpus. And then looking at case studies from the corpus. And this is really exciting because this is actually the first time that we're, or among the first times that we're sharing audio from the corpus with people who aren't involved in the project. So I'm really looking forward to sharing some case studies with you that illustrate how this corpus can be used for pedagogical purposes. And then we'll leave about 15 minutes at the end for questions and discussion. So first, corpus linguistics. Corpus is a large and principled sample of texts that's designed to represent a target domain of language use. And so one way I like to think about a corpus is using this little visual here. So we have a language domain, and the, the language domain is all of the language that we ideally want to learn about. So we could say, for example, we really want to learn about newspapers that are written in the UK, for example, and that would be our language domain. But of course, it's likely really difficult and probably impossible to collect all of the newspapers in this domain of newspapers in the UK, right? And so this is where a corpus comes in. And a corpus, if we design it really carefully in a way that's large and principled, as this definition shows, then the corpus can be a reflection of the full language domain, and we can extrapolate and generalize findings from the corpus to the full domain. And so if we think about conversation in spoken American English, which is the corpus that we'll be talking about today, the idea of having a corpus is even more important, I believe, because if we think about the language domain being conversation that's spoken in the United States, that's a huge and really broad domain, and it really would be impossible to actually collect all of the examples of conversation that happen day to day, minute to minute, in all of the different cities all around the United States. And so this is why a corpus for this purpose is really, really helpful. How do we access corpora? We can have maybe cassette tapes or VCRs. Maybe a corpus is available online in something like the Corpus of Contemporary American English, where we can just search through the language that they have there. Maybe it's something that we have stored on our own computer, but we use a tool such as AntConc to actually access language samples. Or maybe in its most basic form, we just have texts. We just have files within our own computer, our own device that we can use to study language. And one thing that I think is really important to mention when we talk about corpus linguistics is that there is always a linguist within corpus linguistics. So even though, as we saw in those examples of how we might access corpora, many of them are related to the computers. So corpus linguistics can utilize some sort of computational techniques or strategies that utilize a computer, but there must always be someone to actually analyze the language, because that's the end goal, is to analyze language rather than to do fancy things with our computers. So just some examples about questions that can be answered through corpus linguistics. I chose a couple here that have a couple of recent studies from faculty in the department at Northern Arizona University. So one application would be to look at the word thing in academic writing and see maybe how prevalent it is in published articles. And from that, we can come up with more specific advice and strategies to teach our students. And actually, interestingly, that study found out that thing is actually a lot more common than we might think. And so if we use corpus linguistics to support what we're teaching our students can end up being probably more successful in achieving their goals. We can look at how language is used differently across different types of internet publications. We can look at how real life examples of language might be different from language examples that we see in textbooks. And then we can look at things like laughter and how laughter might be used to accomplish different purposes in different languages. So here's a little sampling of some corpora that are available. And these are all, of course, very useful corpora. I chose just a small sample from corpora of English. And if you take a look through all of these, I'll give you just a second to look and think about what's more frequent, written corpora or spoken corpora. Okay, I'm sure you didn't even have to look at the list to guess that actually written corpora are a lot more frequent. And the question is, of course, why? I think the answer comes down to a couple things, but they're all sort of related. And we have challenges with spoken corpora. So obtaining participant permission is really challenging. And it is an issue more so than in written corpora, because if we're trying to collect, for example, a compilation of written academic articles that are published online, you're about to say written, okay. That were published online, then we don't need to obtain participant permission because they already published it. They already want people to look at and use these resources. But with spoken language, usually people don't go around recording their own conversations, so it's a lot harder to obtain permission. And then again, recording speech. So yeah, most people don't walk around and record their conversations. And so this is an extra step that's required. Then maybe even the most challenging part here is transcribing the speech. We need to convert all of the spoken language into a text format. And that's necessary because as linguists and as teachers, we're not going to be able to listen to hundreds of hours of audio in order to teach our students one thing. We want to have it in a text format so we can really much more easily look through and find patterns across all of the texts. So this all comes down to limitations in terms of resources, limitations in the data we have, the resources in terms of our time and our money to complete all of these steps. And so this is where Lana Case comes in, the Lancaster Northern Arizona Corpus of American Spoken English, or Lana Case for short. We thought, because there aren't so many spoken corpora available at the moment, it's actually hard for us to use corpus linguistic methods to analyze spoken language and especially conversation within the United States. And so a little bit about this project, we're aiming for it to be 10 million words of conversational language, which comes out to be about 1,000 hours of recorded conversations. And it's really important that, again, if we want our corpus to represent the larger language domain, we want to make sure that the data that we're collecting is representative of a lot of the diversity that we see within the United States and across the United States. And ideally, if we accomplish this goal, it will be the largest collection of spoken American English that we have, and we hope that it will be really useful for research and teaching going forward. There is a written counterpart called Lana Kaw, and today we'll be just talking about the conversation part, the spoken part, the corpus. Okay, so here's a sneak peek at our team. You can see there's so many people that have been working really hard to make this happen. You might recognize a couple names here, but we have lots of people who have been hard at work with the design, the recruitment, the data collection, the transcription, the data processing, and all of this. So in these next couple slides, I want to talk about the steps that it required slash is still requiring to complete this corpus. And so let's start with corpus design. Here are some elements of corpus design that we had to wrestle with while we were working on this, on designing Lonicase. So we first have to decide what type of data to collect. Do we want to collect just conversations, or do we want to expand to meetings and speeches and things? Who are we going to collect data from? What information about each speaker do we want to collect? It would be really cool to have very specific information about each speaker. So if someone wanted to look really carefully at maybe language background and how it affects your language, you could. But then on the other hand, are participants going to be willing to participate if we have like an hour-long questionnaire that they need to complete? So it's a trade-off here. We need to think logistically about how we're going to collect the data, how we're going to collect participant consent and ensure that the process is ethical along the way, how large is the corpus going to be, and what percent of the corpus is going to be from participants of different demographics. So there's a lot of decision points. One thing that we did to sort of help with these decisions is called a domain analysis. And this is recommended by Egbert, Bybert, and Gray. I don't expect you to read all of this, but basically what we did is we described the domain. So basically the language that we really wanted to represent in this corpus. And then we operationalized it and planned the sampling methods in a way to concretely think about what can we feasibly and logistically collect for this corpus. So we have this ideal image of what the corpus we want is in a perfect world, but then we have sort of the realistic understanding of, well, we can't, you know, secretly record people in their bedrooms or in meetings throughout the day. So there are some compromises we have to make along the way. Just to illustrate some of these challenges is thinking about this question of proportionality. So if we're trying to collect data from lots of different ages, we have a couple options. We can collect equal amounts of data from people of all these different ages. We could collect equal amounts of data from people from different age ranges, or we could try to collect data that is proportional to the population of the United States. And in my mind, these are all viable options. And they all have pros and cons. And so these are the sorts of decisions we had to make. And so we make this decision about age, and then we have to do the same thing for all of the other demographics that we're collecting. So race, gender, region, all of these things. I will tell you that we've settled so far mostly on option C. We're trying to collect data that is as proportional as possible to the population. Yes, there's a question. Should we pause and ask questions or wait till the end?
I wanted to ask while we're still on the slide.
Yeah.
So the option C is how you collected actually the data, or how you are trying to proportionalize the data.
Yeah, great question. So C is what we're aiming for. So we are aiming to make it as proportional as possible, but we realize that if we make, basically, it's not possible to get data that is exactly proportional to the US population in terms of age, race, gender, region, all of these things. And so we're trying our best, and these are sort of benchmarks that we're really aiming for. And they're also benchmarks for us to continuously assess and evaluate how we're doing along the way. And so, for example, just a few days ago, we did a progress report and found out that right now we have more data from this age group. So what we're really trying to do now, and we have been doing this, but we're going to amp up our efforts now, is to target people from the 60 to 69 and above age group. Yeah. Okay. So data collection is the next step. It involves inviting participants to submit conversation recordings. We need to recruit participants who are willing to do this, which involves, of course, lots of work in terms of recruitment, but also in terms of keeping up to date with reminding them, sending them emails, being in close contact with them, making sure to build this rapport. And then sending payments. We do pay participants for submitting conversations, so we need to make sure we send payment on time, or else they probably won't submit more recordings if they think we're not going to pay them. So all of these things are an ongoing part of data collection. And it's really exciting because we have like thousands of participants right now, like 4,000, I want to say. Ellie's very familiar with this data. So thank you. So it's really exciting, but it's a lot of work, as you might imagine, sending personalized emails as much as possible to all of these participants. One thing that's been really helpful, I show you this not because I want you to look at my face anymore, but because social media has been absolutely invaluable for this project. We've done an analysis and we actually have found that over 70% of all of our participants across the United States have been recruited from TikTok specifically. And so that has really helped us not only in recruiting participants, but also collecting recruiting participants from diverse backgrounds. And so we have participation from people in Alaska, people in Florida, so all across the United States, in Montana, Wisconsin, and it's thanks to TikTok, because obviously we can't go in person to all of these places. And so far, with our progress, we've collected about 750 hours of conversations from across the United States. So we're still working on that last 250 hours. And so another challenge that comes to play here is in recruiting from these hard to reach populations. So this is sort of an ongoing question. And if you have any ideas about this, I'd love to hear from you at the end. But basically, how can we recruit participants from some of these harder to reach populations? So low population states, we need more participation from people in Rhode Island, which is a really teeny tiny state. So how do we access these people? People who are over 70, especially, since for the most part, these people are not on TikTok, believe it or not. So that's been a little challenging. Recruiting people from minority racial and ethnic groups. Luckily, again, thanks to social media, we've been doing okay collecting data from these minority groups, but I think the more we can collect from these groups, the better in terms of our corpus representation. Okay, so I just want to show you very briefly some of our recruitment strategies here. These are some of the things that we've been trying. And I will show you some of the things that have worked best. So the things in green are the recruitment strategies that have worked best. So one of them is hosting activities at senior centers or assisted living centers. So far we've held conversation activities in Arizona and in Texas, where we go to an assisted living center and we converse with the residents there. And that's been really valuable both for the volunteers and also for the project. We offer extra credit to students for submitting. We offer double payment incentives. Every once in a while, we'll pay participants double, and that's always successful. We invite our personal contacts and then social media again. Some things I want to point out that haven't been successful. This is the most surprising one, hiring a market research panel. So market research panels are literally paid. We pay them to find us participants. And so we paid them a fair amount of money and they found us participants, but it turns out these participants didn't submit conversations. I believe they recruited about 500 participants for us and we only got 4 hours of data from them. And so this is something that I think it was worth a try, but because the participants weren't personally interested in the projects, they were just interested in the money. Maybe we weren't offering enough money to make it really interesting and exciting for them. Okay, and then next up we have transcription. Let me show you this video. So transcription, there's a ton of steps here. I think I'm going to have to reshare to make sure that I can show you or get you the audio here. Share sound.
Lizzie, let me know if it doesn't work on your end. I'll try to give you access again.
Oh, thank you. Oh, no. Okay, my... Can you see my screen?
Yes, yes.
Okay. Unfortunately, my university has a limitation, so it's not going to let me share sound. But there are captions in this video, so I can still play it.
No, we can hear it.
Oh, you can?
Yes.
Yes.
University. I've been here almost 10 years, and I'm very excited to be working on this project. Yeah, so the pedal is the most useful tool for transcribers. So it's got three functions. In the center, you press your foot down and will play. And then it's got fast forward and fast rewind. And the timestamps correspond on here. So if I play, you'll see the timestamp moving. And we can adjust the speed. So currently it's on 84%. We can, if you want to, you can speed up to a more natural speed of 100%, or you can slow it down. If there's a tricky part and you want to re-listen more slowly, you can slow it down. And the speech isn't distorted, which is really useful. I prefer having it around 80. You can't hear anything because I've got these plugged in. And I just, transcribers often have their own headphones, they're quite a personal item, and they're just very neat, and then they disappear into the recording.
So that's Ruth Avon. She's our lead transcriber at Lancaster University in the UK, and she and our whole team of transcribers are just incredible. They listen to these, and they re-listen to these again and again to make sure that they're transcribing as accurately and consistently as possible. One thing that's been surprising for me with the transcription is that actually there's a lot more ambiguity than you might expect. And so sometimes even with a conversation just between two or three people, it can be really hard to know who's speaking since we don't have videos, we just have audio. So sometimes we're not quite sure, and so we ask that the transcribers will indicate whenever they're maybe unsure about something. Briefly here, one of the other issues or some challenges that we've confronted with transcription is deciding what exactly we want to include in a transcription. So for example, there's background noise. If the phone's ringing, for example, do we want to include that in the transcription? Is that going to be helpful for future research and language teaching? If there's overlapping speech, what do we think? It takes a lot more time for the transcribers to indicate that the speech is overlapping, but maybe that's something that's helpful. Pronunciation, we'll actually listen to some recordings later where the pronunciation is sort of off and there's a marked difference, but should we include that if we're not including pronunciation for other words? And what about laughter, coughing, pauses? So these are all things that we sort of have to decide on how to transcribe consistently. So here's one of the final transcripts that we put together. You'll see we've got the speaker IDs, we've got the timestamps, and we have here a U. The U indicates that it's unclear. So that's when basically the transcriber isn't exactly sure. We can see you with a question mark. They don't really know what was said. So they're going to say that, well, something was said here, but I don't know what it was. So it's unclear. We have pauses. We have false starts. We do have laughter here. And really importantly, we have anonymization to make sure that these things remain anonymous. I'm not going to play this one for you because I have some others to play for you later, but I will say that something that's really special to me about this recording is this is one of the first ones that was in the corpus, and it's between my grandmother and me. And it's really lovely and really special to me because she passed away during this process. But now we sort of have a record. I have a record of this conversation, and she told me a lot of stories in this conversation too. So I think that's one other benefit or advantage to participating in this corpus is as we participate, we're also preserving memories and experiences of the people that we love. Okay. In terms of progress with transcription, we've transcribed about 21% of the corpus, but we still have a lot left to go. Luckily, now we have a team of 10 transcribers. I think I mentioned that. So we hope to be making more progress on this soon. Without further ado, this is the part I was so excited to share with you. Here are some case studies and examples from the corpus with implications for language teaching. So here is a conversation between partners who live in California. We have 102, this is the speaker ID for the female speaker. She's 38 years old. And then 101 is a male speaker who is 31 years old. So again, here's a transcript. You can feel free to read along while we listen. I'll tell you, I chose all of these excerpts because they all are related to tea in some way. So we'll hear lots of different people talking about tea in different ways.
Hello, are you made of jelly?
Here, you can look at her the normal way.
How boring is that? Now look at Papa. No?
Oh,
there we go.
There you go.
There's Papa. Here, I'm making my tea.
Yeah. I wonder if you'll be a teacher. Okay. No, you're more of a. You're more of an espresso gal, I can tell. So, I drank tea when I could.
I think we didn't hear like a last part of it because it was so quiet. I'm not sure if it's just the recording or.
Yeah, thank you. I think it is the recording because they sort of walk away from the mic. Thank you. And that's another challenge that the transcribers have. They're turning it up to full volume, trying to hear these things. Yeah, so, but I hope you heard the beginning part, which is my favorite part when they're talking to their infant. One thing that really stood out to me here is how they talk to their infant. And you probably noticed this. This is something called parentese, which is when adults or parents or adults use slower speech, higher pitch, exaggerated intonation, and even simplified grammar when we talk to children and especially babies. And what's interesting about this is it actually, studies have shown that this use of language actually facilitates the infant's learning of vocabulary, grammar, and social skills. So even though sometimes when we speak to infants, we don't use maybe what's considered to be correct grammar, it actually helps children, it simplifies it for children to be able to acquire grammar later. And even more interestingly, parentese is used in all languages and cultures as far as we know. So this is one universal of language, which I think is really interesting to see it represented in this corpus as well. So let me show you another fun one. This is between cousins and friends who live in Arkansas. They're all female and they're all in their 70s. So feel free again to read along if you'd like.
I'm so glad everybody decided to come to lunch today. And of course, you know, we have our usual smorgasbord and it's so much more pleasant than going to a restaurant sometimes because we don't have to do all that tipping.
Well, for me, it's the barbecue potato chips.
Well, we know you all about the barbecue potato chips and the iced tea we have.
Mm-hmm.
And definitely not sweet iced tea. I don't know where anybody got the idea. My mother drank iced tea all her life. We never had sweet tea in our life.
We did have sweet tea Because that's a Southern thing, but my mother and your mother were sisters, so why?
I don't know.
We didn't make it sweet just to have it in the icebox sweet all the time. We sugared it and lemoned it.
We sugared and lemoned. I always wondered about that. We put the sweet in, and then we put the sour in.
I know.
It's sublime. It's so wonderful.
I don't understand that either.
You don't have celery in ice? No, sweet. Sugar and lemon.
Oh, okay. So the sweet and the acid.
All right.
But then they always say, oh, Southern people had sweet tea. I look at them like crazy.
No, but restaurants, they have it. You have to ask for unsweetened tea.
I know.
Right.
I know that for sure.
So I forgot to mention this, but I'm sure you noticed this if you're reading along, that this transcript actually is not the final version of the transcript. I actually wanted to show you a previous version. So this is the first version that the automatic software produces, but I'm sure you noticed some errors. And so these are the things that the transcribers have to go back and check and change. So this clip was about a minute and a half. So it'll probably take the transcribers about 15 minutes to go back and adjust and fix this one clip. But there are a couple of things I really loved in this file. And one of this is this phrase, we sugared it and lemoned it. And I think this is such a fun and creative use of morphology and derivation, where the speaker is turning nouns that probably should never be verbs, if we're thinking prescriptively, but they're changing these nouns into verbs. And it's verbs that maybe we've never heard before. I've never heard them before. And yet we all can still understand what's being said. And I think this is really interesting and notable for spoken language in particular, that I don't want to say guess, I'll make an informed guess that this type of creative language use probably occurs more often in conversation rather than published writing. And so this is something that if we're teaching our students, especially if they're interested in conversation and speaking for the most part, looking into a corpus such as this might inform us about what sort of things they really need to learn. And that, of course, is an empirical question. I would love, after this corpus is complete, to actually analyze these differences between spoken and written language here. Another interesting thing was the use of barbecue potato chips. It's a noun sequence. So we have noun modifiers of this word chip. And I looked in the corpus, what we have so far, and it turns out that potato chips, a noun modifier, occurs only one other time. And it happens to be also said by someone who's over 60. So a 65-year-old man said this. Apparently he forgot to put potato chips in his peanut butter sandwich. Sounds like a travesty. But then we compare the use of the word chips spoken by other people, and particularly people under 60, and actually these speakers don't use the noun modifier. So we can see that there is some shift maybe over time, or maybe it's just a difference in terms of age. So this might be something that's interesting to look into and share with students as well. Okay. Oh my goodness, another fun one. So friends living in Pennsylvania, one is female, the other is female, and they're both in their early 20s. I must warn you, this takes a bit of a morbid turn. So
yeah,
let's listen. So they agree
not to leave the bed. Mateo wakes up and then Rufus is still asleep.
Okay.
And Mateo's like, let me like make us tea, like I should be a good host. And he turns on the stove and it burns the apartment down.
Oh my god.
So Rufus wakes up and he sees the fire and he's like, oh my god, Mateo, you're so stupid. And he ends up dragging Mateo's, I think they described it as like charbroiled body out.
Oh my god.
Yeah. Like
is he dead?
Dead.
Fuck.
Mateo's dead.
Is he really?
Yes. Like seriously dead.
So I think they're talking about a book or a movie or something. If you know what this reference is, I would love to learn more about it. One thing that I noticed here, maybe you notice as well, is these speakers use the word like a lot. And yet none of these instances of like are using like in sort of the more traditional sense, in the sense that we might teach our students as a verb. For example, I like linguistics. They're all used in different ways. And so I was curious about this and I looked at the rest of the corpus. It turns out that like occurs quite a lot. So many times that I wasn't able to go through all of them manually, but I did take out a random sample of 100 instances. And out of those 100 instances, 0 of them used like as a verb. And I think to me, this is very striking because I personally have never taught about, I've never thought about teaching my students how to use like as a quotative word, for example. But maybe these very initial preliminary findings suggest that maybe when we're talking about speech, there are other uses of like that are also important. And I think another interesting thing here is we have this sort of perception, I don't want to say we, but generally there might be sort of a stereotype that young women, such as the people speaking in this file, use like a lot in this way, in different ways than the verb. But actually looking at the full corpus, again, we see that across all many different regions, ages, genders, we see them using nearly identical uses of the word like. And so that, of course, these are initial findings, so it'd be great to explore that a little more. I'll show you a couple examples. So these are concordance lines taken from Ant Conk. So we can see an example here of like honors. So it was like an honors class. This is an uncertainty marker. They want to signify that they're not exactly sure. We also see, here's the quotative example. So she called her doctor and was like, blah, blah, blah. So here are some examples. These are some of the ones that occur actually the most out of this 100 sample that I looked at. I think we have time for at least one more case study here. So we have friends living in Illinois, a female and a trans man. So let's listen to this one.
It's also my least favorite. I don't like it. It's practically unlistenable. But on our, and I don't say that out.
That is a nuclear blade take.
Yes. It's his first word that he put out, amateur blade. But it definitely set the tone.
It's valuable in its own.
Yes, it is. I enjoyed the cover. But otherwise, it's not my cup of tea. Not my blade.
Not in my blade.
Not in my blade. No. Meow meow. This damn job. But I love my job.
I love my dog.
But I love my dog. Yeah. Meow meow.
Yes.
Your son. I love your son.
I miss him. But I hate that dog.
I hate that dog too. I'm always fiending for pictures of him. Please give me pictures.
I always feel bad if my parents are like, you only come visit us to see the dog. I'm like, but I love that dog.
I listened to this recording quite a few times at this point. The first time I listened to it, I was like, what are they saying? This is incomprehensible. And even now, after having listened to it quite a few times, I still think it's incomprehensible. I'm not sure exactly what they're talking about. But I think this is a great example of an important principle of conversation. So you can see here, you know, there's sort of inside references to blade. Oops, the highlights disappeared. We see almost purposely, We see the purposeful use of almost incorrect grammar. So I miss he, they're saying, they're singing. So all of these things that really signify that these two people are friends, right? Like they understand each other. They can say crazy things and make weird sounds with their mouths. And this is just for them normal, and it signifies their friendship. And this to me really illustrates that conversation does have phatic purposes. And so in the literature, we see that phatic communion is what it was first called. This idea from Malinowski in 1972 that the point of language, and especially in many times conversation, is merely to establish and build connections rather than actually conveying information per se. And so this, I think, is a prime example of how we can use language to build connections. And so I did look up who Blade is. Blade is a rapper from the UK. This is the album they were talking about. And yep, here's information about Blade in case you're interested. Okay, and so I think we are just about out of time here, so I won't play this last one, but I will discuss this one idea here at the very end. So basically in this excerpt, they're gossiping. And at the end, they say, they're gonna be like, spill the tea. And some of you might be familiar with this word, spill the tea. I looked it up on Urban Dictionary, of course, the most reliable of sources. And it says that spilling the tea means to gossip about personal information, sharing the scoop or the news. And we might think that spilling the tea as a phrase and slang has come about sort of recently, but actually using corpus linguistics, we can look back in time and actually see that the first, as far as I know, the first reference to tea, meaning gossip, was in 1994 in a work by called Midnight in the Garden of Good and Evil. So I looked at the word tea in Lanikay so far, and it turns out that 18% of the uses of tea actually have this sort of metaphoric, idiomatic meaning, saying in phrases like spill the tea or what's the tea or I love tea. And many of these are uttered by speakers who are younger, so under the age of 27. But to me, this reinforces the idea that when we're teaching, idioms such as this and slang terms can be important, especially if our students are younger and they want to sort of fit in with and understand and communicate with other people who are also younger. So that is the presentation. I shared these QR codes just in case you're interested in learning more about the project. Here's the website, and then on the other side, there's a publication that basically covers just what we talked about today, but it goes a little bit more in detail. So of course, you're more than welcome to visit those if you like. But I think we have a couple minutes for questions and discussion if you have
any. Okay. Thank you so much, Lizzie. This was wonderful. I'm surprised with this like that it's not used to like a verb. I was like, what? Really? It is a verb.
Yeah.
Oh. And then the point that you made about language being the thing to build a relationship with rather than convey meanings, that's also very interesting to learn. Thank you so much. I loved your presentation. Thank you everyone for attending. If you have any questions, please, you're welcome to speak up or write that in the chat and I can read it for you.
Oh, I've missed some chats throughout. Oh, you've seen the videos on social media. Oh my goodness, yay. That makes me so happy.
So I do see one question from Telly. Do the participants get tips on how to capture clear sounding recordings?
Yeah, that's a great question. And yeah, of course it's tricky because participants are recording on their own devices. So we do say that they won't receive compensation unless at least 90% of the recording can be understood and transcribed. So that in a way gives them incentive to make sure it's clear. And for the most part, they have been sending clear audio. We do ask that participants try to meet in a quiet room if possible, and that they put the recording device in front of them or in the middle of the speakers. And yeah, that's been working well. Some of the issues that have come up is largely when participants forget that they're being recorded, which actually happens all the time. And so they'll like, the recorders will, you know, put their phone back in their pocket and like walk away. And then there's like just a bunch of downtime. And then it's like later when, you know, we hear them say, oh my goodness, it's still recording. Let me stop it. So yeah, every once in a while we get some pocket sounds, but actually for the most part, we haven't confronted too many challenges with that. It's a great question.
I'm also wondering that if we ask them to be always in the quiet room, it will not be like a natural conversation anymore. Not all the time, but sometimes it might influence the speech itself.
That's absolutely true. And so we do get recordings from people at restaurants. We get a lot of recordings from people on the car, like in the car on a road trip. And yeah, we love it because it is more natural. That's a really great point. It's because it's conversations that they'd be having anyways, but it does make it a little bit trickier for the transcribers. So yeah, again, as everything, it's a trade-off for sure.
Okay, there is one more question. What's the recording? What's the deadline for getting recordings? Maybe I can post on my social to see what who can help.
Yes, thank you. That would be amazing. So, yeah, I would really appreciate you sharing this information with others. The deadline is every month on the 15th, and then we send out payment on the 16th. And right now, we remunerate participants with $25 in Amazon gift cards for every hour of conversation that they send in. And so, yeah.
As far as I know, the conversation could be about anything, like about weather, or maybe you met with someone you didn't see for a very long time. As long as you're feeling comfortable recording it, it's any kind of conversation is welcome.
Yeah, totally, totally. We are hopefully going to wrap up data collection in October. So if they could, then that would be ideal.
There is another question from Sue Jean. I'm sorry if I didn't pronounce that right. I'm curious to know what drew you to this research and field of study.
That's a great question. Yeah, I'm wondering how far back to go.
Maybe not too far.
Back when I was three. So lots of it happened here at Northern Arizona University. I'm a PhD candidate right now, so I'm in the third year of my PhD program. And something that really inspired me to learn more about corpus linguistics is the faculty in all the classes here. You might know that NAU has a good reputation for being really strong in corpus linguistics. So I'm really grateful for all the opportunities I've had to learn about corpus linguistics here. In terms of conversation, I think one thing that made me really interested in this is how complicated it is and how I think perhaps understudied it is for how complicated it is. So we see, of course, there's lots of writing an academic article is definitely complicated, and there's a lot of studies explaining how and why it's complicated and how we can teach our students. But in terms of conversation, partly due to the lack of resources, to the limited availability of conversational data, we don't have as many clues or tips for our students. And so I do really hope that this resource can be used for teaching in the future.
Thank you. There's another question that I missed from Elizabeth Bonar. How many people participated in this research so far?
Yeah, so how many people signed up versus how many people have participated are two different questions. Ellie's familiar with this.
I guess participated.
Yeah. So we've gotten signups from 4,000 to 5,000 people. So we have completed consent forms and demographic backgrounds for about 5,000 people. But we have received conversation submissions from about 1,000 maybe. So that gives you an idea of sort of the rate of attrition here, where we're losing about 75% of our participants throughout the process. And so we do try to alleviate this. One thing I mentioned super briefly is that we do double payment incentives every once in a while. And that's extra helpful for the people who have signed up, but they haven't contributed yet, because they're already interested. They already took like a 5-minute survey to say that they're interested and that they're willing to participate. So as soon as we offer them double the money, then they're really interested. So that's something we try to do to reduce the rate of attrition.
Any other questions? There is one. Do you only have native English speakers among your participants?
Yeah, that's another really great question. And one that I'm totally open to having more discussion about. So the difference between native and non-native, as you all know, is super complicated, and people have different ideas of who's a native speaker and who's not a native speaker. And people can also sort of self-identify as being native or non-native, but someone with the same characteristics in terms of their language background, two people with the same characteristics could identify different ways. So if we relied merely on self-reporting of nativeness, that could be problematic, and that could reduce, not problematic in that we would receive submissions from diverse participants, but problematic in that the corpus, then we wouldn't really know what's in the corpus. If two people are saying they're native, but they have different backgrounds, it's challenging to understand sort of what we're looking at. We want the data to be as homogeneous as possible. And so we've operationalized a speaker of American English in that it's a speaker who has lived in the United States since before elementary school. And so I do understand that, of course, there are plenty of other speakers of American English who haven't lived in the United States since before elementary school. And so that decision is, it's definitely can be problematic because we're not maybe including all the speakers that potentially could be considered speakers of American English. But the trade-off here is that we can be sure that we're collecting data from a homogeneous population as much as possible. And so that's sort of the route that we decided to go with. Yeah, so for around 4 or 5 years old, basically.
Why did you decide to include since elementary school, not earlier or not later?
Because we're thinking about generation 1.5. So people who moved here when they were quite young, maybe they were born in a different country, but they've grown up here all their lives. And so definitely their language will have influences from the language their parents are speaking. But if they have grown up in the United States, our guess would be that these people would self-identify as being speakers of American English. And so that's why we decided with that age, especially because we see these younger years are really formative in a speaker's language development. But I lost it from 4 or 5. Interesting.
Okay, yeah, that makes sense. And it's also interesting to consider. There is a few more questions, and I think we're going to finish here. So lived in the US since before 4 or 5 years old, right?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Those participants. Okay. Do you have more female or male participants? Does it matter for collecting the corpus?
Yeah, another great question. It turns out in linguistics research, and I would dare to say in linguistics more generally, females tend to be a lot more enthusiastic about participating. So in fact, if you look at lots of different studies, you'll see that, I don't want to say all the time, but most of the time you'll notice that there are more female participants than male participants. And that's the same case in this research. Female participants are a lot more enthusiastic about contributing to the corpus. And so at first we didn't control for this because we thought, well, the population is basically 50-50, so we'll probably end up with something around there. But for a while, we had like 80% of our participants were female speakers. And so we've been addressing this, and now we have, I just calculated this earlier this week, we have 60% female speakers, 10% speakers from other genders, and then the remainder male speakers. And so we're hoping to continue addressing this and to get more male speakers and reduce the amount of female speakers we have.
Does it matter for the corpus that you have?
Yeah, probably depends
on what separation.
Yeah, I think some people may be interested in studying differences between male and female speech. Okay. So in that case, it would be helpful. But at mm-hmm. this point, if you say, okay, we have 30% from male speakers out of a million words, that's still mm-hmm. quite a lot of words to use in the analysis. So,
yeah, that's true. Okay. Tali says that she was born in New Jersey. First language was Cantonese, but I lost it from 4 or 5 years old. She can participate, right?
Absolutely.
Okay. That would be great. Okay. Any other questions? Then I'm going to stop recording here.